All right, so let's start with something that I know you've spoken on before. We're in the Gen AI era, right? We have all become obsessed with productivity. We want to work faster. We want to work better. So from the outset, how should employers and HR pros think about measuring, obtaining, and achieving productivity in the workforce?
Well, they shouldn't. As soon as you talk about generative AI as a productivity tool alone, it's telling employees not to adopt it, right? So if you're sitting at work and you're like, okay, here I have this new tool for you, and they're worried, they have to learn something new. Human beings love mastery. So you're going to take away my mastery, maybe even take away my identity, because that's how I define myself. They're going to be worried they might lose their job. And they're going to be worried at the end of the day, if you adopt all these tools, they're going to be asked to do more with less, right? And so one of the things I talk a lot about is when you talk about this super exciting technology that really is transformational, you need to talk about it as it will drive productivity, but it also has an opportunity to make work better for the employees. Like, think about all the annoying tasks, those things that we call toil that like just sucks your will. If we could point Gen AI at that and then leave you with the stuff that gives you joy and energy and sense of learning and accomplishment, that's how you should talk about Gen AI. And so you could tell like I'm on a little bit of a soapbox, but it's we're shouting from the rooftops, productivity, productivity, productivity. That's also shouting to many employees, I don't want to touch this stuff.
Calling it productivity is really talking to that C-suite rather than talking to the actual employees. But like you said, if you have toil in your job, like for me, it's emails. Like I don't want to write emails ever. But if you could point it and have an excellent email written for me, like this is stuff that I have used in my day-to-day, that's unbelievable. And you see that continuing that path. But there's going to be productivity tools. Now, what would you call it if not productivity tools?
Making work better.
Making work better tools.
Making work work.
Because you want to make the employees happy. So you have to articulate this to the C-suite.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and when I say making work work, it works better for the C-suite who are really representing the shareholders, right? So shareholders want productivity. Making work work for customers, it could deliver more innovation, better experiences, richer customization, personalization. But it also has to make work work better for employees, more joy, less toil in day-to-day work, right? And so you have to think about it holistically. And it's not just think about it. It's not just marketing. How am I going to market this Gen AI stuff to my people? You have to approach it that way. So you have to say, okay, we're going to bring this technology in to transform what we do, and we're going to do it in a way that actually does make your work work better. And if you do that, you'll be happier. Like, so for you, it's emails.
Yeah.
Someone else might love emails, right? One person's toil is another person's joy. Maybe I'm a great email writer. You know, I don't know. Some people really probably get a sense of accomplishment from getting the 500 inbox down to 50 or zero, right? When you get it down to zero. Ah, okay. If this could help you get there, but if it does all your email for you, you might miss the couple that maybe you wanted to reply to. So you have to be careful and be radically employee-centric in how you approach bringing these tools in.
So a lot of the times, like employees are going to have this toil that's not really visible to that C-suite. They're going to have this stuff that they do that can be improved by Gen AI. How would you go about evaluating or even asking these employees, like, what can we do to make your day better using this tool? Like, how would you go about asking?
Because exactly
it's a difficult question, right?
Yeah, no, exactly that. So one of the things we do is we developed a survey instrument that we ask employees to, if you say, hey, listen, we're bringing this technology. We want to rethink your work in ways to make it more efficient for shareholders, more effective for customers, and more enjoyable for you. But we need some data to do that. So what we ask employees to do is we say, just look at your calendar from last week. And we give them a set of tasks. So for office workers, it's like focus work, administrative work, collaborative work, learning and development. Like, just what do you do during your day? For a salesperson, it's different. For an engineer, it's different. So you just take the basic 5 to 10 tasks. And we say, look at your calendar and just how much time did you spend on each of them? And then for each of those tasks, we ask them, you know, on a scale of 1 to 5, right, or something, how much do you enjoy those tasks? And if you don't enjoy them, why not? And we also ask them, how effective are you at those tasks? And efficient and effective. And if you're not efficient and effective, why not? And then you could use that data to say, okay, where's the win-win? Where's the stuff that sucks their soul that you should point AI at first? And where's the stuff that gives them joy? that you should be very careful not to point technology out. And can I give you like a little historical context?
Please.
On employee centricity? I'm old enough to have started working in the late 80s. And the late 80s, everything was around shareholder return, right? More money for shareholders. And that's what the senior executives are maximizing. People would talk about making customers happy, but they're like, we can't afford that. We can't afford that because if we give more features and more service, it'll eat into shareholder returns. Well, around the 2000s, people started proving that wrong. And the tech industry really dove into that and showed how customer obsession, right? Empty seat at the table, Amazon customer at the table, Microsoft's customer obsession, right? Putting the customer at the center yielded so much profitability, right? So in fact, the most valuable companies in the world by market cap in the 80s and 90s were all the industrial companies like car companies, oil and gas, that invested in assets and got the cost down. They couldn't afford to make the customers happy. Now they're replaced with the most valuable companies in the world being all the tech companies that put customer first, right? And everyone else, the industrialists, are trying to catch up. What I think we're on the precipice of is saying, wait a minute, shareholders first and customers first, but we still treat employees as a means to an end to deliver for the shareholder and the customer. Productivity, productivity, productivity. But I believe that if you elevate employees, who, as I said earlier, are customers who choose every day how much energy to bring to work, if you elevate them and their enjoyment of work, yes, joy, not engagement, joy is a real word. If you elevate them to be as important as your shareholders and customers, it will drive more profitability. And it's not just theory. There's company after company after company that proves this out. Like, do you shop at Costco?
Sure.
Do you know what like turnover of employees in retail is, the retail industries?
No.
High double digits, right? It's like some retail companies can lose 100% of their employees a year. They're just churning, churning, churning. Do you know what Costco's is?
I'm assuming less.
Like 7%.
Why?
Because they're so radically employee-centric in what they do and how they do it. And people love working there. And when you love working there, can you imagine if you reduced your employee turnover to 7% and your employees love their work every day? I mean, go into a Trader Joe's. Everyone loves working there.
That is true.
Costco, Trader Joe's, higher sales per square foot, higher sales per employee than any of their competitors. And they do things like overstaff the store so people are not as stressed, right? So they're doing things that on paper look more costly, but they're employee-centric. So this applies not just in retail, right? But to engineers. Imagine if you could reduce the attrition of your best people, you just lose productivity in ramping up new employees. And you could double, triple, quadruple the motivation of everyone who comes to work and says, I am ready to deliver today with joy and enthusiasm and motivation and inspiration, what that does to profitability. So it's not just some like Debbie theory, it is proven out in many companies who have the courage to be radically employee-centric. And I think it's going to take on steam just like customer centricity took on steam in the 2000s.